of a sudden the spleen don't show up. What's going to happen? The pancreas shuts down. The liver says, I'll come back tomorrow. You and I alone cannot walk in the fullness of grace. We need a body that functions. The body needs each other. The body is no good unless it's connected to the head, who's Jesus. Every believer faithfully devoted. Say, every believer was faithfully devoted.
Every believer was faithfully devoted.
Okay, this is after salvation. This is after salvation. Ask for the grace for this. This is after salvation. They devoted themselves to follow the teachings of the apostles. Their hearts were mutually linked to one another, sharing communion and coming together regularly for prayer. Look this up in different translations. This is just one. These are four distinct things that they committed themselves to, were devoted to. A deep sense of holy awe swept over everyone. And the apostles performed many miracles and signs and wonders. All the believers, say all.
All
the believers were in fellowship with as one body, and they shared with one another whatever they had. Say, whatever they had.
Whatever they had.
These statements are just so massive statements when they have all and every and all that. I mean, it's like, wow. Out of generosity, they even sold their assets to distribute the proceeds to those who were in need among them. Daily, say daily.
Daily.
This wasn't that, okay, Sunday and Tuesday we're going to meet, you know. Sunday you come, daily. They met together in the temple courts and in one another's homes to celebrate communion. They shared meals together with joyful hearts and tender humility. They followed a daily discipline of worship in the temple, followed by meals at homes. Every meal a celebration, exuberant and joyful as they praised God. People in general liked what they saw. Every day their number grew as God added to those who were saved. The early church experienced God's favor by positioning itself in the paths of grace. What are some of those paths? What are some of the paths of grace that's found in this passage? Anyone? Flip back. You know, what are some of the paths of grace? Which one poked out at you? What are some of the paths of grace?
They followed the daily discipline. That it wasn't just the, yeah, we're going to do this thing every third week or the bar or whatever.
And what are some of those daily disciplines? Okay, fellowship is a discipline. How many understand that? Fellowship. That was pretty good. I like that. A disciple is a follower. Disciples follow paths who they're following. Those are the disciplines. Let's not make it in something that it's not. We really want to follow Jesus, we'll follow his example. Okay, good. Someone else. What paths did you see in here?
They continually gave on a daily basis in areas of need.
Okay. How many heard it said before? That people who are givers there's a flow. When we give, the flow comes in this way. If we stop the flow stops coming into us also. That's good. God's called us to be a river. I like what Maxwell said. God has called us to be a river that flows out, not a reservoir where we contain things. God's called us to be rivers.
And in here too, I guess, I mean, I'm just going to say this is my general opinion, but I think as they shared God's word with others because they grew, and I think it wasn't just only God, you know, Jesus sharing, they were also sharing his word too for the growth of the community.
And how can you share the word with others?
You just have to find that opportunity.
You got to have the word yourself.
Yep, and you got to be fed yourself.
You got to have it in here first, right? And these are just brand new believers. So they dug into what? The teaching of the apostles. Because the New Testament wasn't written right. They dug in. I like what J.I. Packer says, the doctrine of disciplines is really a restatement and an extension of classical Protestant teaching on the means of grace. Packer's got a great book on it. It's called Knowing God. It's a very good book. He says the disciplines are the paths of grace. Of a blessed life. That's what it is. How about if we just call, instead of saying disciplines, they got into the path of grace. Does that sound better? Instead of you're in trouble. The paths of grace where we will encounter Jesus. Now here are just five of them that are illuminated within that passage that I saw. But if you really are interested in, now I'm going to preach on these five things, these five qualities, paths of grace. Preach on these. If you're really, there's a book out by Richard Foster called The Celebration of Discipline. And he's got 12 different disciplines where which are paths of grace. One of the disciplines that I found helpful in that book is the discipline of silence. And being silent before God. Fasting is a discipline. Prayer is a discipline. Worship. Attention. They devoted themselves to the Word of God. How many know that God's grace is in His Word? It moved. God, Jesus is there. We want to encounter the path of Jesus, it's found in His Word. We want to encounter the path of Jesus, it's found in His people. How many of you here had a word from God through His Word, but sometimes it comes through people? Prayer, a life, which is a life in the Spirit. Because it's in Romans 8, 26 says, we don't even know how to pray as we ought to, but the Spirit helps us. We don't even know how to pray as we ought. But the Spirit. Praising God. Which is faith. How many know when you really can't praise God, if you can't praise God in it and for it, you don't have any faith there about God in it. Just think about it. If you have a hard time with your job, can you praise God for your job? Can you praise God for your employer? Can you praise God for your brother or sister or mother or friend or what? You know, all the. If you can't praise God for it, chances are you're not trusting God in it. You really can't see God in it. That's faith. God is, and godly leadership. There's not a question, there's godly leadership in there. Grace. grace comes through God in creation. And to me, the results of that grace was a holy awe. There were miracles, there were signs, there were wonders. There was, out of this came generous giving, a generous giving life, a joyful heart, fruit of the Spirit, corporate discipline, a positive attitude, and growth. That's what I saw in that passage. All that just kind of flowed out of these paths of grace. Let's stand. Let's read this one. Walk out of your old dark life. Now that's a different path, isn't it? Walk out of those old paths. Don't follow those old paths and those old ways. Walk out of your old dark light and put on the armor of light. May we all act as good and respectable people, living today the same way as we will in the day of His coming. How many know that? Have you ever been in a bar? You know how they clear the bar?
Turn on the lights.
They turn on the lights! It's 2:30. Clip! All of a sudden, you just see it. Oh my goodness, it's time to leave. You just turn on the light. If we're in these dark paths, what do we need to do?
Turn on the light.
Turn on. Yeah, I'm a faint. My name's Rod. I'm a simple dude. Just turn on the lights. That's all you got to do. And how do you turn on the lights? Well, bring some people that you know have some light in there. Open the Bible, bring grace in there, all of a sudden, the light turns on. Do not fall into patterns of dark living, wild partying, drunkenness, sexual depravity, decadent gratification, quarreling, and jealousy. Instead, wrap yourselves in the Lord Jesus, God's anointed, and do not fuel your sinful imagination by indulging your self-seeking desire for the pleasures of the flesh. Don't make provisions. Don't follow those paths. Follow the path where Jesus is. And He will overwhelm us with His grace. Okay, let me say this one more time. Yes, God is more than ready to overwhelm me with every form of grace, so that I will have more than enough of everything, every moment and in every way. He will make me overflow with abundance in every good thing I do. Father, we come before You, and I ask Your word. You say in Your scriptures that You hover over Your word and to perform it, and that Your word will not return void. Now, there's been a lot of scriptures here, and Lord, I ask You to hover over them in our hearts like an incubator and cause growth in our life. Illuminate the path that we're on. Help us to choose paths of Your grace that will give us the ability to say no to those old paths and yes to You. Thank You for who You are. What we heard today is a simple message. It may not be that easy. Give us the faith to simply follow You. In Jesus' name.
Go back to that passage in a moment.
76, 79. I wasn't getting along with my first wife. We moved from Ohio up to New York. I lost my job. That brought me really way down. She was working nights, waitress. I'd be looking for work during the day. Finally, started hitting the bars. Hitting on the bartenders. Looking for women in general. Met this one gal that I really liked. We would go to motels and stuff. Twice. My first wife knocked on the door and saw us. I broke her heart in a million ways. Finally, I thought we'd worked it out. But I had one more thing to do. I didn't have to go start a whole new life being a good guy and all this stuff. When my first wife found out that I was finishing up what I told her I was going to do. And I came home to a toolbox, suitcase, and a note saying, don't come back. I never wanted to hurt her again. Never. I would leave, let her find somebody more worthy. And so I did. Found Kathy. We hit it off. We were both going through hard times. Fell in love. Got married. But all the quarreling, wicked living, sexual depravity, I tell you what, I was the king of it. I was the king of it. And I had to wonder how did God ever bless me with two wonderful children, great wife, two beautiful grandkids. And if that's not grace, I don't know what in the hell it is. He has given me that kind of unmerited favor. And I look at my grandkids, I just know how lucky I am. Because by all rights, I probably should be dead some mad husband. I've been chased by a couple. It took a rough spot in our marriage to get us to see Ron. God brought Randy Goff into our life. Randy and I have been friends for a long time. He's going through trouble, and he gives me this card to this guy, some preacher. I didn't know from Adam. He's a godly man, good man, patient man. Because, boy, my stomach. I don't want to change. I have to be convinced. But I thank you, Ron, for your patience with me to allow me to get into the path that Jesus would grant me that kind of family.
Hey, Mike.
I could give you a lot more detail, but it's just salacious information to say. We'll let it go.
Mike, if you think you wrote the book on that stuff.
I know
I at least read the book.
Well, I can tell you, it was written about me because I'm older than you. And I'm not proud of it.